Grant McInnis will get us started. Adarius Lemons to return. Lemons will not bring it out. So Kentucky not only dealing with history, but also this loud crowd. And Cole Kubla, cramped quarters down there for the visitors.
Tom, it's not just the strength, it's not just the talent that the Florida Gators are going to put on the field. It's the swamp, and it's the student section. It's literally 5 feet from the visiting bench. One of the most difficult atmospheres I've visited as a player. They're calling your name out between every single series. You can hear everything these guys say. Without a doubt, the closest proximity between fans and players on the bench in the SEC, Kentucky's going to have to deal with it tonight.
Told you some rowdy reptiles, but I'm sure they'll only say nice things about you. Felipe Franks getting the start for Florida. Jordan Scarlett is his tailback. And Franks wants to throw on first down. He wants a deep ball down the sideline. Trying to find Van Jefferson. The transfer from Ole Miss, Derek Beatty's got great length. He had the coverage. Franks got off to a fantastic start last week. He's from the Panhandle, originally committed to LSU's brother played college ball, and he's rooming with one of his wide receivers. Five touchdown passes in the first half last week for Franks. And Franks is going to run it. Runs into a wall and is only able to pick up a couple. He's got a pretty good one next to him in Jordan Scarlett as we look at the Gator starters.
Yeah, Felipe called his own number there, a design quarterback run. But this offense is built to run and play action pass off the run. Jordan Scarlett didn't have a ton of run last week. They didn't need him. They had an emphasis on throwing the football and getting Felipe Franks comfortable. But against this 3-4 stout defense, they're going to need Jordan Scarlett heavy and a lot tonight.
Only six carries last week against Charleston Southern.
And just as I say that, they go empty back five wide.
On third and eight. Four-man rush for the Cats over the middle. And that is caught. Great first down by Josh Hammond. And a pickup of 10.
Great accurate throw by Felipe Franks on a big third down to get this offense going early in the game. He's got Josh Hammond right over the middle. Jordan Griffin all over him there. And great job with concentration on a double catch that they needed on third down.
Florida had seven players suspended last week. They returned six of those, including Kadarius Toney, who we'll see on the offensive side of the ball. Jordan Scarlett with the touch. They are still without C.C. Jefferson for another night tonight on the defensive side. Gain of three. Here's how the Cats start out defensively.
I mentioned they're a 3-4 defense. They're going to have three big stout guys up front, and they're going to have one really talented buck linebacker. It's going to be all over the field. Josh Allen, he's a preseason first team All-SEC and a guy the NFL is drooling over.
Leading active sack leader in the SEC, and he's coming off of a 10-tackle performance against Central Michigan. Second down, seven. Another four-man rush. And they flush Franks with four. And Franks throwing on the run. May have snuck it in there. They say it's incomplete to Tyree Cleveland. Florida's offensive line catches a lot of flack, and for good reason. Franks was sacked 28 times last season. And there's some thought from Matt House, the defensive coordinator for Kentucky, that they can get to him without bringing an extra man.
Absolutely. This is one of the things that, as a young or inexperienced offensive line, sometimes it's not where the pressure's coming from, but where's that fourth rusher? So it might feel like a blitz, but it might really be Josh Allen lined up off the ball or on the right side or the left side. You're going to see him here at the top of your screen in a traditional defensive end position. And you see Jordan Scarlett to that side as well. They might be chipping him on a third and long here in a passing situation.
It's Martez Ivey, left tackle. Play clock almost ran out on Franks. And it goes to the slant, and that's good for another first down. Tyree Cleveland on a gain of 11. Mike Edwards, the safety for the stop for the Cats.
Great job. Slot receiver here just runs a go route to clear it out. It's a short dig, not really a slant. It's a short dig on the outside by Tyree Cleveland. Two really good completions on third downs, and Florida's been bad.
Gators converted the first two third downs tonight. They were only 2 of 9 on third down last week. Into Kentucky territory, first possession of the game. Four wide this time. Play action to Scarlett. Franks flushed again, trying to direct traffic. He'll try to take off himself, and he's escorted out by Cash Daniel. Only a gain of 3. Dan Mullen, first season as a head coach. He had great success against Kentucky when he was at Mississippi State. 8-1 against the Wildcats. Led Mississippi State to their first ever number one national ranking. And parlayed that into a return to Gainesville, where he was the offensive coordinator and quarterback's coach under Urban Meyer. Here's Scarlett, right side, trying to find some room. He does! He's got a first down. Let's get you back to the studio and check in with Dari. And that was a great crowd on hand at Rocky Top today for a team that didn't win a single conference game last year. It was a good sign in Knoxville. Quinton Bohanna, sophomore from Cordova, Tennessee, is the injured Kentucky Wildcat. Felipe Franks gets a chance to catch his breath, and he'll chat with Dan Mullen over on the Florida sideline. Injury timeout on the field. We're going to step away for a timeout as well. Opening. Take a look at how Felipe Franks is the readiest this week, brought to you by Holiday Inn Express.
Yeah, as you look at when a quarterback develops, is he seeing the field right? Pre-snap, IDs the right safety, the boundary safety, then you see pressure. Last year, Felipe would have escaped the pocket and moved on. This year, he resets, finds his read once again, and throws a ball with touch that ends up being a touchdown. Those are things you're seeing Dan Mullen have that effect on Felipe Franks. He's talented as anybody in the country. The mental aspect of it is what Dan Mullen is so demanding of, and you've already seen it start to progress in the right direction.
One of the strongest arms in college football. This is Jordan Scarlett changing direction. Crawls forward. Big miss up front for Kentucky, Cole, with Quinton Bohanna leaving the game.
Tom, stops on runs in the middle like that are going to be key. Quinton Bohanna out. Spoke to defensive coordinator Matt House before the game. He told me he's going to play two nose guards in this game. Timory Dubose and Quinton Bohanna were the two. You may see a shift from a defensive tackle. Either Phil Hoskins or Adrian Middleton may have to slide down to the nose some in this game. If Bohanna can't come back, that's a big loss for the Wildcats.
And it might be a big advantage for Jordan Scarlett in this Florida running game. Franks checks to the sideline, trying to get Dan Mullen's attention. And he'll check to his receivers on the left, 2nd and 7. Check to a run. Scarlett bounces out of trouble. Can't escape all of it, though. Josh Allen got his hands there after Cash Daniel turned him around, and it's a loss of 2.
Great pressure right up the middle here. Just blows up that run before it can even get started. Cash Daniel came right through the backside A-gap. That run was trying to go front side. Backside guard didn't come off in time, and the linebacker, Daniel, was able to split the gap and make a great play in the backfield. 3rd and long here.
Gators have converted the first 2 third downs.
Kentucky playing zone coverage right now. 2 safeties.
Pressure again from Daniel. And incomplete. Felipe Franks having to pick himself up, and he is slow to do so.
And that's the 2nd time Felipe has come up. Like, he got a little banged up on this one. You're going to see pressure on the left side coming from this direction, and he can't get his feet set. Cash Daniels up that side.
Fourth and 9. Offense stays on the field, and the officials will blow the whistle before they get the snap off and a timeout taken by Kentucky. And they were caught off guard, I think, by Frank staying out there. And he is frustrated. And you can understand behind that offensive line that last year and now to face that kind of pressure in the first real opponent this season, why he'd be frustrated.
Yeah, it's adversity. The first time this Florida team is seeing adversity, how do they respond? You got to turn that frustration into some positive movement for this offense.
After getting planted in the Florida field turf a moment ago, Felipe Franks asked his O-line, who had that guy?
Yeah, slide protection here. You're going to see all this left side going to the left. But what I want you to see, Fred Johnson, right guard, over slides, and you're going to see Cash Daniel come right down that middle. He's supposed to come off. He's got to push and then come back off. There's only four guys rushing. They had the numbers.
So the answer is nobody.
Exactly. Felipe was frustrated for a reason there. His right guard, Fred Johnson, has got to come off and got to see that. Slid too far to really nobody.
Tommy Townsend to punt it away. He'll take his time. David Bouvier will not have a chance to return. Gators trying to down it inside the five. Inside the 10 will do. Tyree Cleveland, the first man down there. 26-yard punt down to inside the 10. It'll be a long field for this Kentucky offense to work with. Terry Wilson from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, by way of junior college, redshirted at Oregon. Last season, Garden City Community College out in Kansas, and he makes his first SEC start tonight.
Extremely talented, a dual threat guy. Got his feet wet at this level last week, made a few mistakes. Florida's really got to keep an eye on his mobility, got to keep him in the pocket.
Kentucky turned it over four times in the first half last week. Benny Snell gets his first touch and will create some breathing room. But this crowd is something Terry Wilson has never played in front of.
No, I played in community college. You might have a few hundred people in the stands, let alone, what, 80, 90, 100 grand, however many are in the stands right here. This is a new environment for Terry Wilson. Let's see how he responds to this adversity.
He's got a great tight end to lean on C.J. Conrad. He's supposed to be a key part of the game plan tonight. Here's Snell again. And a couple of yards for Snell. Voshon Joseph with the tackle. How can C.J. Conrad help out Wilson?
Well, he's going to help out in a few ways. He is huge in the run game. You're going to see him off the line of scrimmage, blocking backside, lead blocking for Benny Snell. He's all over the field in the run game. A little underutilized, I think, in the pass game. They got to get him going. Just three catches for 9 yards last week. He's a more dangerous target than that, but in the run game is where he's most valuable for Kentucky.
Not a good sign for Florida. Sophomore cornerback Marco Wilson being tended to by the athletic training staff. He had coverage on the outside. And he just kind of crumpled when Dorian Baker took him down, and he's holding his left knee. Wilson out of American heritage in Fort Lauderdale. Comes from an athletic family. His dad, Chad, played at Miami. Brother Quincy played here.
And he's their best cover guy. And in a Todd Grantham defense, as aggressive as he wants to be, you got to have those cover guys on the outside.
Timeout due to the injury. Kentucky looking at a 3rd-and-2 when we return.
SEC Saturday Night is presented by Holiday Inn Express. Be the readiest. And in part by Academy Sports and Outdoors, the official sports and outdoor retailer of the SEC.
Well, here at the Swamp, the Gators have one of the best winning percentages in the country, especially since 1990, where they won 84% of their games, and you can see why. But lately, they've been about as reliable as cryptocurrency and just about as consistent. A pair of trips to the SEC title game and a pair of four-win seasons over the last 4 years. 3rd-and-2. Wilson replaced by Trey Dean at corner. Terry Wilson trying to take off for the first down, and he picks it up before Voshon Joseph brings him down. A 6-yard scramble. Here's a look at the Florida starters, and there's a ton of confidence coming from the back end of this Florida unit, including Chauncey Gardner-Johnson, who had a pair of sacks last week.
And how about that? A little trash talking during the week. Don't mind it. Love it as long as you back it up, but he makes this defense go. He's as versatile as anybody on the field.
Preseason first team All-SEC. A bullet mishandled by Lynn Bowden Jr. And it will leave 2nd-and-10.
Jordan, I talked to Kentucky offensive coordinator Eddie Graham before the game. I asked him, what does Todd Grantham give you? What are the easy shots that you can take away and force him into something else? He kind of rolled his eyes and he said, we're going to get so much man tonight, they don't give you much of anything. He said, we might have to move the pocket, think about being creative with our quarterback, but man coverage, they're expecting to be an issue.
And that's why Lynn Bowden right there, you saw, is so valuable, because in the slot, he's going to get a little extra space from that man coverage to work.
Four to the right side for Kentucky. And Wilson fires into the slot. Bowden just shy of the marker. A gain of nine. Gardner Johnson the stop.
And like I just said, when you play man coverage, all those corners and DBs got to play on different levels. So on the outside, they're usually pressed. And as the receivers work inside to a slot receiver or a tight end, those DBs usually have to play a little further off. So Lynn Bowden is going to get a lot more looks tonight if Florida keeps playing man.
Third down, one. Benny Snell. Wilson split out to the left. And in motion was Wilson. Snell will take it. He's got the first down, and he's rumbling for plenty more. Benny Snell Jr. is one of the best in the country at picking up yards after contact. He is a load to try and bring down.
That's the misdirection in the backfield here as you see Terry Wilson coming. That widens out those two defenders and leaves that crease for Benny Snell to pick up that first down.
Miscommunication in the secondary for Florida. Wilson has to scramble, and he's got plenty of room down the sideline. Terry Wilson finally forced out of bounds by Donovan Steiner. It's a quarterback dash. It covers 31 yards.
This is one thing Todd Grantham was worried about. You got Ja'Kai Polite coming off the edge and Jeremiah Moon coming off the edge. You got to rush to certain levels. You can't pass the level of the quarterback. Watch this. Number 99 gets too far upfield and leaves a rushing lane for a very athletic, very dangerous Terry Wilson.
Todd Grantham teaches his guys get 5 yards deep, then make an adjustment. That time, he went nine.
Yeah, you can't run past the quarterback. You leave those big rushing lanes.
Opening drive for Kentucky. Here's Benny Snell on the toss. Great blocking on the edge. And Snell will have this one brought back. It was a great block because it was a hold. Josh
Holding.
Ali had
number 82 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Three plays, first down.
David Smith the call. Josh Ali had Chauncey Gardner Johnson all wrapped up. Spun him around.
And you can't do this as a receiver on the outside. Got to let him go at that point. Once you engage, that DB tries to get away or move direction, you got to let him go. All you got to do as a receiver is get in his way, force him to pick a side, and allow the running back to react off you.
He knew it. He had the hands behind the back, on the back of the shoulder pads, and he ripped them off late, but it was just not soon enough.
Wilson design quarterback run. Another stop for Boshon Joseph, a gain of four. Mark Stoops has done a fantastic job of rebuilding this Kentucky program. They have met or exceeded their win total from the year prior each of the 5 years he's been there. Another bowl last year as they played in the Music City Bowl. But this game, this series has been a hurdle no Kentucky coach has gotten over since 1986. Wilson leaves the pocket, throws off his back foot, end zone! Touchdown, Kentucky! David Bouvier, a 29-yard touchdown reception.
Wilson's pass complete to number 33, David Bouvier.
That will quiet the crowd in a hurry. And when you have an athletic quarterback and they get outside the pocket, it's scramble drill. A great job by David Bouvier. He's got an out route, sees Terry Wilson scrambling, works upfield. And it's that second reaction play that is so dangerous with a mobile quarterback. That's something that they rep and work on in practice. Paid off there.
David Bouvier had one career reception coming into the season. In the first two games of this year, the former walk-on at Lexington Catholic has a pair of touchdowns. Wilson improvises and Bouvier cashes.
And it was Bouvier is going to have an out route right here on a backup safety in Brad Stewart. And it's that second reaction as Terry Wilson escapes the pocket. And that's when Stewart's eyes get caught in the backfield. And Bouvier makes a crucial play upfield. Great second reaction. That's one of those things. Tom, you mentioned it. Bouvier, one career reception coming into this year, but you have a new quarterback. Sometimes it's a reset button when you're a receiver. You haven't had a relationship or you haven't had a ton of options with a previous quarterback. A new guy comes in, and that's how relationships can get going. Obviously, a lot of comfort from Terry Wilson and even Gunnar Hope, the backup quarterback, and David Bouvier right now.
Yeah, Bouvier had the touchdown right before the half last week against Central Michigan. That came from Hope. Lemons decides to bring it out. 4 yards deep, and he gets submarine shy of the 20. It has been a while, and it is turning into a historical streak. Notre Dame beat Navy 43 consecutive years, starting in 1964 until Navy snapped it in 06. Nebraska, with so many great teams, Bob Devaney, Tom Osborne and company, absolutely dominated Kansas. That streak ended in 04. And Oklahoma, they had Bud Wilkinson, all the stars they had in Norman, did not have an issue with Kansas State from 1937 to 1968. And now there's this, the longest active win streak in an uninterrupted series over a major opponent. 31 consecutive games they have come in all form and fashion, some imaginable, some unimaginable. Franks will step up straight in the pocket. And he gets pushed out of bounds. Last year was another in a long line of heartbreakers. Kentucky had a fourth quarter lead. They gave it up by failing to cover a wide receiver, not once but twice. And a holding call kept them from being in field goal range. Mark Stoops and his staff did a sensational job getting that team back together to win its next two games and to get to a bowl, because that could have been a crippling loss.
Yeah, it could have been one of those things that changes the mentality of the entire locker room, and it can just go downhill from there. Great job rallying the troops, and a great start already to this game.
Well, Michael Pirine is now in at running back for Florida. The Gators have an embarrassment of riches at that position. Scarlett started. We'll see Malik Davis and Damian Pierce, among others, likely off the bench.
Crucial third and short here. This is a big drive. If you're Florida, we don't really know much about how this team responds to adversity just yet. Kentucky gets a touchdown, got to put together a drive to answer.
On third and one, Franks. And he gets undercut. Did he get enough? Darius West with the stop.
Tackle by number 25.
The second time we've seen a design quarterback lead. Just a direct snap to Felipe Franks. He's got a running back blocking ahead of him. One thing Dan Mullen said, he said, you know, I don't think we're going to design many runs specifically for Felipe. He'll run it in the option game, but already you've seen him multiple times on design quarterback runs early in this game.
Dan Mullen has had his best success with quarterbacks who are able to run the ball. Typically those with great physical stature, going back to Tim Tebow, of course. Room on the right side for Michael Pirine.
Tom, you mentioned that play last year. Luke Del Rio looking for Freddie Swain, uncovered, no Kentucky defender on him. I spoke to the former Gators quarterback this week. He said, the thing that people don't know, Freddie Swain and I had shoulder surgery together, so we went through all of our rehabilitation together. We had a little bit of a different relationship. He said he actually could not see that he was uncovered. It was a run play. He didn't check, but because of the nonverbal communication between he and Swain, he decided to take the snap, turn, throw, ends up as a Gators touchdown.
Kentucky changed their substitution patterns after that. They were trying to run a unit on and another one off. A little option look for Franks. Tries to cut it back. He'll take a big hit from Josh Allen. And that'll leave third down. Offensive line trying to pick him up. That's Martez Ivey. I talked with Felipe last week. about his offensive line play. He goes, you know what, we pick each other up. Sometimes I need to be the one that gets them going in a lackluster summer practice. Sometimes they need to get me going, but it's a very good relationship at this point, which you could understand if it wasn't after all the times he got hit last year.
But one thing that Felipe's learning to do is be vocal and take the reins of the leadership on this team. That's come with the confidence that he has under Dan Mullen now.
Remember, he got pulled from this game last year. Frank stands tall in the pocket. Wide open! And a big gain for the Gators and Jordan Scarlett out of the backfield. 31 yards. That'll pick your spirits up.
That was fantastic by Felipe Franks. And one of the things I've had my eye on in his development is staying patient in the pocket, climbing in the pocket, and not panicking when your first read isn't there.
They'll stop play for an injury issue. Derek Beatty Jr., one of a handful of talented cornerbacks for Kentucky, seems to be cramping up just as Florida wanted to pick up the tempo.
Watch how Felipe Franks climbs in the pocket, looks right, looks left, nothing's there. Find your outlet. One-on-one matchup with Jordan Scarlett on Cash Daniel. That's a matchup you want to see every time if you're a quarterback. And I love the patience. Love the patience by Felipe Franks.
He got some good tutoring this week. Heisman Trophy winner Timmy Tebow, our colleague, was in town. Spent some time in the quarterback room with the guys. He was out in the field for a long time with them on Thursday's practice, out there with quarterback coach Brian Johnson. So both Brian Johnson and Tim Tebow played for Dan Mullen when he was their coordinators here at Florida and Utah respectively, and they're able to share that experience with Felipe Franks.
Yeah, I think part of that is between the ears. Everybody knows that Felipe is as talented as they come. It's the confidence, and it's also shutting out the noise. I think last year Felipe let the Twitter notifications, the trolls, the negative feedback get to him and get to his confidence, and Tebow told him directly, and I quote, "No one else can define you. You define yourself." And Felipe really took that to heart. He's a more confident quarterback. He's hearing it from guys that played for Mullen. He's hearing it from Mullen. And you can see it in little plays like the one we just saw.
And last week against Charleston Southern, there were some opportunities to call running plays. And Dan Mullen told us, he said, listen, we had these RPOs built in, and we told them, we want you to throw. They did it for a reason, to build that confidence, to put him in position to have easy gets, and that's what it turned into.
Yeah. One thing to do it in practice, another thing to do it in games.
Well, look at that. Hey, there's some history. Speaking of Heisman Trophy winners, the head ball coach is in town tonight. We'll visit with him as they honor one of his SEC championship teams. And Mullen said, yeah, he still pops in the office every Monday, goes, hey, why don't you throw this post route? Guy's open, go deep. Minute to go in the first quarter. Van Jefferson escapes one, gets a block on the edge, and he's got a Florida first down on a gain of 12.
Great job. Get your playmakers the ball. Van Jefferson, you saw Felipe look to the sideline. They saw they had numbers. Flip it out there one-on-one with your playmaker. He's been a special addition to this Florida offense.
Over 1,000 yards receiving for Jefferson between Ole Miss and Florida. Franks on play action going end zone into coverage, and it's batted away, but a flag on the play. Darius West may have had a right arm around Hammond as he swatted it down with his left hand.
Felipe is going to get bailed out a little bit here. That wasn't the best decision. Double covered down the seam.
Holding, number 3 on the defense. Penalty is 10 yards from the previous spot. First down.
Jordan Griffin is the one that gets flagged.
Yeah, it's just right there. And that, I don't know. I'm an offensive guy, so I'm always in favor of these pass interference, but that is as little of a hold as you're going to see. But you can't let that hand get extended. It can be in close, and you can grab some jersey and hand fight at times, but that hand extends and grabs, easy for the ref to see.
They said it was on Griffin. It was West who was closest to Hammond. Scarlett off of Frank's left hip. He's the lead blocker. They're going to step back and try a pop pass. Now Franks reverses field, trying to use his speed inside the 10. And he's finally forced out of bounds. You see where the mark is. A 9-yard scramble for Franks. They'll say first and goal. Call it an 11-yard gain, Cole.
Jordan, I know you went back to that seam route, said it wasn't the best decision by Felipe Franks. However, what sticks out to me watching him on film is his decision-making and how much it's improved from a year ago. Last year, I think maybe he tries to force that football in, knew it wasn't there, turns it into a big play.
So first and goal out of the shotgun. Franks, option, pitch, Scarlett, and we got a whistle before it started. And Scarlett knows it was a missed opportunity.
The previous play is under further review. Ruling on the field was in the short of the touchdown.
This is going to be a hard one to see exactly where he went out. A lot of bodies over there. Franks went airborne at the end of that run. But Cole, to your point right there, we saw a couple design quarterback runs. Oh yeah, this is the Scarlet. No, that's the penalty there. The review in the Felipe run, the scramble here, was a design gadget play. They ran quarterback option a couple times, tried to hit Hammond.
We've got pylon cam tonight.
Oh,
this is an experimental one. It set the line to gain marker. And so we certainly appreciate the SEC and their officials by allowing us to use this, only the second game it's been used, and then we'll move it to the goal line if it is first and goal. They want to see if the ball broke the plane.
Trying to see right there if his right foot is out. Didn't look like it. I think that spot's right. If anything, back it up a hair, and they're trying to see
right there.
It looks like green grass. I don't think he's out. I like that pylon cam, though. I was going to say it might be hard to see, but we had a front row seat right there.
Well, yeah. And
trying to piece these camera views together. This one shows you right where that ball is going to be.
Until DeAndre Square kicked it.
I mean, where'd they put it? On the put it around the one?
Yeah.
So I think if anything, they might back it up a yard. It looks a lot closer to right on that 2-yard line or so. Maybe even a little further back. Depends where and if you can piece together those angles right where he went out of bounds.
Yeah, it should have been where the ball was when he touched out of bounds. It's not where the ball was when he went over the sideline, but when he touched. That's when he marks him down. Dan Mullen continuing to coach.
Fell spinning forward a little bit. Those perimeter runs, those option plays with quarterbacks and Scarlett are nice, but this is where John Hevesy, the offensive line coach, wants his group to be able to get wins north and south. He wants to get movement off the line of scrimmage, something that the Florida offensive line has not had a lot of success with the past few seasons. I know Dan Mullen wants to give that group a chance to prove themselves. See if maybe they go behind that group between the tackles here to try to punch in a touchdown.
I think they should. And we saw it in practice just the other day. Mullen was getting on these guys to be more physical.
After further review, the runner crossed the sideline at the 3-yard line. The ball will be placed at the 3-yard line. Please reset the game clock to 3 seconds. 3 seconds. The clock will start on my signal.
So it'll be second down and just inches, well, a yard, a full yard, I suppose. And they can still pick up a first down by getting it inside the 2.
Keep in mind, again, here, no Quinton Bohanna for the Kentucky defensive line. Big loss down here in short yardage.
And Bohanna, 340 pounds. You want that kind of guy.
That's the end of the first quarter.
Down on the goal line.
So the first quarter comes to an end. Kentucky trying to shed the demons and end a losing streak that dates to 1987. Terry Wilson, the junior college transfer, playing in his first ever Kentucky-Florida game. And David Bouvier has the Cats out in front.
For the glory.
So Kentucky strikes first, and now Florida trying to answer as we start the second quarter in the Swamp. Sophomore Felipe Franks, a quarterback. Second and one, and he wants to throw. They get their hands on him and take him down. Phil Hoskins with the sack of Felipe Franks. It's a loss of nine.
So that slide protection again, Tom, that Jordan mentioned a little bit earlier, and Fred Johnson again at right guard, sliding a little bit too far over, opening up a big gap, and thus the Kentucky pressure.
Well, and Cole, again, he comes off a guy when he shouldn't. He comes off of the guy that ends up tackling his quarterback. Don't slide past pressure, right? You're on a guy, stay there.
And Kentucky without their starting nose, Quentin Bohanna, left ankle injury. He's questionable to return to this game. Now third and 10 after Florida thought they had the first down run in the Frank scramble a couple plays ago. Four-man rush. Franks, incomplete. Scarlett may have heard footsteps. George Jones and Mike Edwards were there to greet him.
Pressure off the right side of the line of scrimmage as well. Josh Allen working on Juwan Taylor, and even with a catch there, probably still a field goal.
They have a fantastic field goal kicker, Eddie Pinedo. The best kicker in the country last year left early to go to the NFL, so freshman Evan McPherson is now the man. 29-yard attempt for McPherson. He was 2 for 2 against Charleston Southern last Saturday night. Tommy Townsend, the holder. And McPherson keeps the streak going. 20th consecutive field goal made by this Florida team. Let's get an update from Kyle Field. Back to the studio. Here's Dari. Good sign. Meanwhile, Clemson has a 14-3 lead on Texas A&M. 2.5 to go before the half. It's a pretty good game brewing at Kyle Field.
Yeah, I think if you're Texas A&M and Kellen Mond right now, just down 11, 14-3 before half, you can hold on to that. A lot of people thought that Clemson could run away with that game. Texas A&M's got a lot of talent. They're not there yet, but man, going punch for punch with one of the best in the country, Dabo Swinney, Clemson.
Dabo and Jimbo have split their previous 8 meetings. Lynn Bowden back to receive. And he won't even bother fielding.
The kick is now to the end zone for a touchback.
Let's get down the field, check in once again with Cole.
Tom, I'm going to show you how this slide protection breaks down. What it is gap protection. So you're essentially just sliding one step, and this is your gap that you have to protect. What Jordan's talking about is if you have a defender to your right and you're slide protecting to the left, you have the ability with your eyes to protect this gap, but physically you want to stay and help with this gap. Same thing if you have a defender here. If you're sliding, you know you have this gap and help in this gap, but your eyes can play the backside gap. Have to use your eyes in slide protection. It's not just your body. It's not just physically, visually, you can still win.
And those breakdowns mean that Kentucky has been able to affect Felipe Franks and make him move with just 4 rushers.
Timeout, Kentucky, their second.
They're getting ready to take a delay of game, so the Caps instead will use their second timeout of the half. Eddie Grant and Mark Soups not happy with having to burn a timeout here early in the second quarter. Welcome back to the Swamp, also known as Steve Spurrier Field now. Kentucky with a lead 7-3 over Florida. And you'll never guess who wandered into the booth. Chance to honor his 1993 SEC championship team. Head ball coach joins us. Thanks for stopping by.
Tom and Jordan, good to be with you guys. Yeah, it was neat to be down there with that 93 team. It was only 25 years ago, but as coaches, we tell them if you win a championship, it's going to be forever, and this was our chance to celebrate this weekend.
That was one of the great teams in Florida history that kicked off an amazing run, and you had a chance to on your guys moments ago, and one of the guys you called out was Terry Dean, who was your quarterback for part of that season. Why was it so important to get him acknowledged in front of this crowd?
Well, he was super those last two games against Alabama. He was 20 of 37, threw two touchdowns, ran for one, and our man Chris Doering threw him a 15-yard pass.
Doering threw him the pass.
The Eagles worked the first
You drew that one up, right?
No, it's the same thing. Run it over there and throw it back to the quarterback. So Doering, he threw that several times here.
Doering loves hearing his name mentioned, by the way. Yeah. Second and five, and Wilson will flick it out to Benny Snell, and he's able to take it out to the 35-yard line. How important was that team in establishing what you guys eventually accomplished here?
Well, Tom, we won it in 90 and 91. We lost the championship game in 92, so we're sort of always knocking on the door. And to beat Alabama in Birmingham, the first 2 years they had it there, I guess they thought Bama needed a little edge or something. But they had it there, and then they finally moved it to Atlanta. So our guys just really played well both those games.
On third and one, Wilson takes it forward.
Obviously, Florida making some moves, wanting to bring a championship back here. You've been around Dan Mullen. You've been around this program. You've seen championship teams. What about Dan Mullen say, oh, yeah, I got some confidence he can do it?
Well certainly he's got a great opportunity. Those teams that are up there fighting for championships, they better be in the top five in the nation in recruiting. Mm-hmm. You look at Georgia, Ohio State, Alabama, and all them guys. So that's where we got it. I mean, we got good players now, don't get me wrong, but we got to recruit, and then we'll be right there with the best.
First and 10 now for Terry Wilson and this Kentucky team. Of course, Kentucky fans well aware of a long losing streak to Florida. It's been since 1986. And, Coach, it's happened in every way imaginable and unimaginable. You mentioned Doering. Of course, he had the game winner one time at the buzzer. What is it about this series?
Well, I don't know. They had a great chance to beat us there in 93 when Danny hit Doering with 8 seconds left. So we escaped that one. We played them here in the Swamp in 91, and we're up 28-7. And the next thing I knew is 28-26. And fortunately, we put a drive to run the clock out and score a touchdown. But Kentucky sort of, it's hard to figure how they lost some of them.
Yes.
It's just a snake bit when they play us. I guess that's the only way to say it.
Well, they've had great players. They've had good coaching. They've had outstanding players in that time. But it just seems that Florida always has that number. Is there something to the attitude of Florida, whether it's Kentucky or others, like these are just games they expect to win?
I don't know about that. We never talked about it. Of course, that was a long time ago when I was here. But you just try to get prepared to play one at a time the best you can. And really don't talk about streaks and things like that.
Cats have converted all three of their third down opportunities. Now third and four. Pressure coming. And it's C.J. Conrad, the tight end, with another grab.
Coach, I saw you down there with your 93 team. You look like you still got some gas in the tank. And you're going to be coaching again. Alliance of American Football in Orlando starting up the feeder league for the NFL. Tell me about that.
I tell you what, Jordan, I'm really looking forward to it. This is my kind of coaching. This is 4 months a year. We'll practice the month of January and play February, March, April. We got like 10 games, hopefully two playoff games. And they allocate the players, so there's no recruiting. We're not going to be calling guys all over the country. We'll get a team and go try to beat the other guys. And, you know, if you love competing and so forth, this is perfect for us.
How important is that to give a big population of guys another chance to get film and possibly continue their dream?
It could be called the Opportunity League.
Ooh. He's swaying with a big chance for a return. Mm. And he's finally forced out of bounds. It's a 25-yard return.
Yeah, as we all know, there's not enough room in the NFL for all the really good college players that come out. So this will give these guys an opportunity to do their thing, and hopefully after they play in the Alliance League, they'll go to the NFL. That's what we hope happens.
Hey, let's take you back to 1993. You mentioned it. Danny Werfel able to find Chris Doering with 2 seconds left. They're in cover three at that point, if I'm not mistaken.
No, they were in a cover two.
Oh, there
he was wide open. Yeah, I don't know. Some teams like playing cover two at the end, Jordan. I don't know why.
You send a guy right down the middle.
Yep, one down the middle, one down the sideline, and Danny spotted Doering, and that was the start of the four in a row that we won. If we don't win that one, we don't win the one in 93.
And there were some games you guys won where you didn't play great football. You just ended up pulling out. If I'm not mistaken, you had 7 picks in that game.
Well, we may have that game, but That 93 team scored more points than any SEC team. We broke a bunch of offensive records. And then they were broken later, though, so they didn't hold them a long time.
So after the punt, Florida will be back out on offense. Here's a look at some of the numbers that you guys put up. All of those were SEC records at the time. Points scored, passing yards, passing touchdowns. And you had a really good running back. You called Eric Rett moments ago perhaps the best running back ever to play here. There's been some good, really good ones.
Yeah, Eric got a chance to start all 4 years. So he got a lot of carries, and he caught more passes. He could do it all. And we got the lead. He was the guy that gave him the ball, run the clock out, and he was really a good back. Great, one of the great backs I've ever been around.
He put up some big numbers. He caught a lot of passes. Franks. Speaking of the running back catching passes, swings it out to Malik Davis. What kind of offense are you going to run in Orlando?
Well, I tell you what, I've been watching some of Florida's offense. I watch their game tapes and everything. So there's some new tricks going around. So we'll be a little bit of a spread, but we're going to have the quarterback under center, too.
Love
and
that.
I'll tell you what was interesting. Three of my fullbacks from 93 all came to the reunion. Kelvin Randolph, Jerome Evans, and Chris Bilkey. They were all at the reunion and so forth. And I told those guys, I said, we're going to have a fullback on our team again.
How about that? Yeah. We got flag on the play after a tackle in the backfield by Tymier DuBose. We saw a lot of those guys at the hotel last night. I tell you what I appreciated was just the camaraderie. They were so happy to see each other and spend some time around each other.
And a lot of the guys hadn't been back in 20 years or so, they said.
Face mask
so
on the
it
defense.
Was really
number
good
98.
For them.
15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Good call. Got him right on the face mask. Helped him bring down Malik Davis. That'll put Florida into Kentucky territory now. What'd you enjoy the most about being around those guys this weekend?
Just seeing them for the first time in a long time. Seeing their kids. Terry Dean, he's got two children here at the University of Florida. And it's good to see Terry back with all his kids, wives, and so forth. And most all the players brought their families with them. So that was probably the most neat part. And then we rehashed a bunch of games and so forth. But it was a team with a lot of spirit. They all loved each other. Shoot, every championship team's like that. So.
Franks finds Kadarius Toney. That's good for a first down. And a gain of 15 that time. Dan Mullen said that you guys have a great relationship. You're not afraid to pop in there on a Monday and say, hey, why aren't we throwing the deep ball more?
Yeah, we exchanged a few ideas. I told him I really like one pattern they ran last week. I said, I'm going to use that myself.
The double post?
Well, it was a post against a four deep with two guys clearing out on one side.
Kadarius Toney takes a direct snap and will carry it 9 yards. Last week against Charleston Southern, Dan Mullen kind of restored the roar here at the Swamp. They even brought out the jump pass. What's it like just when you see a guy who was part of the program and he's reaching back to re-engage his fan base?
Yeah, that was a good start. Everybody, was very happy. Oh, there's one there.
It is wide open for the score. 18-yard pass from Felipe Franks. And Florida's got its first lead of the game. Earl Stevens with the reception.
Yeah, I really like a lot of the RPO stuff. Yeah. Billy Gonzalez and Dan do there. So I've been learning some new tricks.
How new is that, the RPO? Did you do it back in the day, or a version of it?
Oh, late at South Carolina in 14 or so, there was a little bit going on. But probably really 16, 17, 18, 15, 16, 17, 18, those years it started coming around.
Really taking off.
Yeah,
you see every offense doing at least a little bit of it.
Even
every
the Saturday. NFL's copying the college guys.
Eagles do a ton of it.
They do.
The Eagles run it. Chiefs run it. Uh-huh. And the Eagles got their season started on a good note Thursday night. So Felipe Franks with the touchdown pass, and he's still chatting with his offensive line, making sure the protection's right.
Yeah, that was a good drive for us. That was a good
after
drive.
The play was over, unsportsmanlike conduct number 13 on the offense. A 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the kickoff.
Florida hasn't lost to Kentucky since 1986, one of the rare years that you weren't coaching. You're in between
jobs. That was an off year. That's when I was looking for work. And fortunately, an opening came at Duke University where I was as an assistant coach. So that was That was the opportunity that kept my coaching career alive, Duke University.
And the rest is history, honoring your 93 team here tonight. They didn't lose to Kentucky, not Florida, to lead. Steve Spurrier, thanks for stopping by.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. Thanks, Jordan.
Head ball coach, not the old ball
coach. That's right, head ball coach.
Head ball coach is in the house here at the Swamp, where they almost never lose, in Florida out in front of Kentucky, thanks to good quarterback play from Felipe Franks. It's 10-7 Gators. Kentucky get the ball back in a moment. On second and 10. Wilson. Flushed out by Chauncey Gardner-Johnson. He went through just about every progression and some of them twice.
I'm going to tell you guys what, Kentucky center Drake Jackson's having a game. Really been nice helping out in protection. Got him a slab right there. Goes to the rib cage, helping out his right guard. Gets a decleater. He's been nice in the run game, blocking back, zone scheme. He's got movement at the point of attack. He was a really welcome presence late in the season for the Wildcats last year. Thought he played great down the stretch. He's been phenomenal here tonight.
Figures he'd go to the slab. His parents run Smokin' Jack's Barbecue Shack. Third down and 6. Pressure again. And Wilson somehow completes it. It's Taven Richardson who takes it for 18.
Pass complete to number 11, Taven Richardson.
Zakai Polite and Terry Wilson around the ankles.
Another great play by Terry Wilson. Polite rushes upfield, and you see early in the game, we saw him rush all the way past the quarterback. Now he redirects, gets some pressure on Terry Wilson, but a great job and a second reaction on the outside by Taven Richardson.
Wilson, 6 of 8 tonight. Looking left all the way. And that one will one hop the wall. Dorian Baker was the closest Kentucky receiver.
And Wilson's really been the difference maker tonight. I mean, we saw Kentucky struggle last week against Central Michigan. They put the ball on the ground 5 times, lost 2 fumbles, 2 interceptions. His decision-making has been much improved. Even better than that, instead of throwing into coverage, he's using his legs to create second options for his receivers and positive yards outside the pocket.
Wilson originally committed to Nebraska, ended up spending a semester at Oregon. On 2nd and 10, tries to run for it up the middle, lost the football, and Florida pounces on it. Jeremiah Moon has the recovery just when you praise Wilson for better ball control. It gets punched out by James Houston, the fourth. And it's Florida football.
And that is a huge mistake. 5 minutes left in the second half. You're driving to either tie the game at worst or take the lead before half. And now you give it right back to Florida.
Kentucky thought they had the momentum. Instead, they forget the football. Back to the Gators. Franks, incomplete. And it seemed like if Tyree Cleveland would have hauled that one in, it would have been clear sailing.
Boy, that's a play they hit a few times last week. The RPO, the run pass option, that means that Felipe Franks is making a decision after the snap. As I just mentioned, that previous play, if he would throw it, that wouldn't be an RPO. If you see numbers and you throw it out to the outside, that's not an RPO. It's after the snap, seeing a linebacker suck up and throwing it behind him. Great play call and really close to a first down there on a good slant.
Tommy Townsend on to punt it away. David Bouvier, who has a touchdown catch for Kentucky, back. And Bouvier will let it go over his head, and it will kick into the end zone. 49-yard punt for Tommy Townsend. 3:17 to go in the first half. Kentucky will have the ball when we return to Gainesville. From the Swamp, Gainesville, Florida. Great crowd on hand as the home crowd wants to see this streak extend to 32 consecutive games against Kentucky. Terry Wilson turned the ball over last time on the field for the Cats. He'll get another crack at it with 3:17 to go in the half.
One timeout. Everything's still on the table here. You don't need to panic.
You don't panic if you're the chain gang. You just got to unknot the thing. Got to figure it out. In this day and age with our technology, still worrying about chain links.
Chain links.
Measured the distance to the moon. And we got a chain link keeping track of 10 yards. They'll move that chain. And maybe they will just lay it down. Here's Benny Snell into Florida territory. Finally tracked down by C.J. Henderson. A 44-yard romp for the SEC's leading rusher a year ago.
What a great start to a pseudo two-minute drill with just three left. And Cole, you mentioned it. Drake Jackson, the center, with an unbelievable back block right there that opened it up for Benny Snell. And he's I said it, probably one of the most talented, if not the most talented, back in the SEC. Doesn't get the credit I think he deserves playing at Kentucky.
71 yards for Benny Snell thus far tonight. He has half of their 147, roughly. Snell again. Benny Snell did not have a great game against Florida last year. They're able to hold him in check. 14 carries, 59 yards, and he didn't have a touchdown. But heartbreak at the end of that game for everybody in a Kentucky uniform. And Snell put it simply, we were the better team. It was a one-point loss for Kentucky. Snell's put up all these great numbers in his career. And remember, he didn't get off the bench the first two games of his freshman season. Second down, five. Snell threw an arm tackle. And then into the pile. And that will leave third and about two.
Florida a little confused there with the unbalanced formation. Just a right tackle and nobody else on the right side of the formation that time for Kentucky. Florida struggling adjusting right now to these formations that Kentucky's bringing.
Cats have been great on third down tonight. Snell hit behind the line, sheds a guy, and he rumbles for another Kentucky first down.
And one of the reasons I say he may be one of the most talented, if not the most talented back in the SEC, that play was blown up, Tom. There was nowhere to go, no hole, no anything. Slayton blew that up in the middle for Florida, and Snell just made a play.
Drake Jackson surveys the front for Florida. He will look between his legs for the leg kick from Terry Wilson. Wilson taking a shot. Underthrown and intercepted by C.J. Henderson. Gators with takeaways to snuff each of the last two Kentucky drives. Great student section here at the Swamp. Kentucky looking at a third down. They've been leaning on Benny Snell again. Wilson will vacate. Snell to take the direct snap. And he punches his way through and nearly broke out of there. 7-yard stumble for Benny Snell and some words for T.J. Slayton afterwards.
Yeah, but keep an eye on these high snaps. We were singing the praises of Drake Jackson early in the game. We saw a high snap on the almost fumble on the pitch to Benny Snell and a high snap there. That can completely throw off the timing, especially in Wildcat. That needs to hit quickly. That snap is an important aspect of that.
High snap helped lead to a near fumble from Wilson on the pitch to Snell a little bit earlier. Fresh set of downs out of the pistol. Snell to the outside. And he ducks his way through for another first down. 18-yard run for Benny Snell Jr. He's over 100 yards on the evening.
Well, when we spoke to defensive coordinator Todd Grantham, he said, this is what we want. We want Benny Snell to bounce. But you only want to do it if you can make tackles on the outside. And C.J. Henderson overran that. Otherwise, it would have been a good stop for Florida. Instead, it's a big gain for Kentucky.
Kentucky's been great when Benny has. He's at 121 now, averaging 9.3 yards a carry. And Snell again, pardon me, A.J. Rose again. In Kentucky's offensive execution over the last 2 years with Stephen Johnson at quarterback, they were a great play-action team, and Stephen Johnson had an affinity for hitting the deep ball. How much of that was predicated on Benny Snell's effectiveness?
Oh, it's huge. And anytime you get a defense or force a defense to put 7 or 8 guys in the box, that extra guy is coming from somewhere, and usually it's on the back end, which means you're going to face more single high, more man coverage on the outside, which is great for play action. Might be a spot to do it here if you're Kentucky.
Trips to the left. Snell hit behind the line, spins away, and it's a first down carry. Rashad Jackson, the first man, couldn't get his hands on A.J. Rose. Gain of 9 for Rose, sophomore from Cleveland.
And that was just an RPO there. They had Lynn Bowden in the slot. Terry Wilson's going to reach the ball out, see if anybody reacts. If no one does, he hands it off. And boy, there hasn't been a ton of really good-looking blocking outside of a few early drives for Kentucky. They've been solid. But man, these running backs, both Snell and Rose, are making plays happen after contact.
10th play of the drive. They've been heavy on the run. 8 runs, just 1 pass for the first 9. And on the flip fake, Terry Wilson's going to take it to the edge and in. Kentucky back in front on a 24-yard run by Terry Wilson. Kentucky Wildcat
touchdown run. That right there makes Eddie Gray and the offensive coordinator for Kentucky really happy. That's a great play design. It's off that same pitch that we saw earlier, nearly the turnover. Instead, they bring a lead blocker and go right through the C gap. That's a designed run. Set up off that play earlier in the drive where there was almost a turnover. That's great. That's great job by Eddie Gray there, the offensive coordinator.
Miles Butler on for the point after. And he pulled it, but just snuck it in. Benny Snell has 121 yards, and now quarterback Terry Wilson is over the century mark. 9 carries, 107, and 1 touchdown to put Kentucky back in front of Florida as they look to end the skid.
Full tip is that design on the touchdown. It's a toss counter. This action here is going to expand the defensive end, and then backside, you're going to see the guard pull, pick up the linebacker, and that's a freeway to the touchdown for Terry Wilson. You're going to watch and see the over pursuit by the linebacker's backside because of the movement, the toss, and the pull, and that sets up that counter and cutback for Terry Wilson. Man, Eddie Grant's going to love that one on film. He's going to watch that and go, hey, that's how we drew that up.
Number 25, Florida trails Kentucky 14-10. Second lead of the game for the Cats. Adarius Lemons to receive for Kentucky. Decides to bring it out. He gets a key block. And then a flag, and Lemons takes it past the 30. To the 31-yard line.
During the return, holding on the receiving team. Penalty is 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
This season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's general scholarship fund. Thank you, Allstate. UCF knocked off South Carolina State tonight. 15th consecutive win for the Knights. Their new head coach, Josh Heupel, came to Orlando from Missouri, where he was the offensive coordinator the last few years. Felipe Franks will hand it off. This is Jordan Scarlett. Jordan Scarlett takes it to the 25. Cash Daniel brings him down. Kentucky has run for 251 yards on 26 carries tonight. They've outgained Florida by almost 200 yards on the ground. How surprising is that, given Florida's talent in the backfield?
Extremely surprising. It's not that they haven't had an opportunity to run the football. That's Jordan Scarlett's fifth carry of the game. That's unacceptable right there. Four carries for your bell cow in the first half. You got to give him more touches than that. I understand at times you got to take what the defense gives you, and they want to involve Felipe Franks as much as they can and getting him layups and easy throws. But this offense is predicated on running the football and play action pass off that. They have to get Scarlett and these running backs going.
Third and three, and they told us in our meetings this week that they went to the pass more often last week against Charleston Southern, knowing they had a physical advantage. Five wide now.
I'd look out for a QB draw here.
They need 3 yards. Franks pressured, flicks it, and it goes for a first down. Tyree Cleveland picks up 10. Josh Allen was bringing the heat.
Second or third time we've seen Felipe Franks calm under pressure, climbing the pocket. Martez Ivey, the left tackle, gets beat here. Josh Allen is on the quarterback, but he steps up, makes Josh Allen turn that corner a little further, and finds Tyree Cleveland right over the ball. Tom, if he doesn't step up there, Josh Allen gets him. But it's those little movements in the pocket that make Allen's path to the quarterback a little longer, and that half a second to complete that pass.
They're working on the right calf and the left of Josh Allen, who brought the pressure a moment ago. The active career sack leader in the SEC right now.
Tom, they can't handle many more hits up front. Quinton Bohanna, starting nose guard, the 6'5", 340-pound sophomore, came out of halftime in street clothes, so he will be out the rest of this game.
Tamir DeBose has been playing behind him on that Kentucky defensive line. Not a whole lot of depth up front for the Cats. First down after the completion from Felipe Franks. He is 8 of 14 through the air tonight. Franks throws on the run, incomplete, through the hands of Jordan Scarlett.
They try to go double move there. I'm really surprised we haven't seen more easy layup throws for Felipe Franks. One thing Dan Mullen emphasized week one, gave him opportunities. He didn't pull the trigger. I figured we'd see a lot of hitches, curls, flats, a lot of easy throws and progressions for Felipe. Haven't seen a ton. They're trying to take shots on first down.
Dumps it to Scarlett. It's taken down by Mike Edwards.
Great coverage there. Smart move by Felipe to dump it down, get something, make it a manageable third down at third and six now.
Yep.
Check down goes from third and 10 to third and six.
Dan Mullen has pounded it into Felipe Frank's head. You can't go broke taking a profit.
That's true. Positive yards, however you can get it. I know you want to take the shots downfield, but manageable down distances are crucial in close games.
Will Kentucky bring pressure? Here comes Mike Edwards from the edge. Gets into Franks, knocks him down. The pass is completed. Trayvon Grimes, the Ohio State transfer. What a job by Franks facing the pressure again.
Little zone blitz there. Josh Allen drops back. You mentioned it. Mike Edwards, the safety, comes in, gets Franks low, but a nice completion, Jordan.
Fire blitz. off the outside. Don't see the hit there. We're looking at the catch. He does it. He secures it, but it was even more impressive. Felipe Franks took a big hit in the gut right as he released that ball. It's why it ended up a little low.
Malik Davis to tailback for Florida. Out of the pistol now.
Prior to the snap, false start, 73 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
That's a senior from Apopka, Florida, left tackle Martez Ivy. Dan Mullen told Cole at the half that he was pleased with their O-line protection, but Felipe Franks has been facing some fire tonight.
Yeah, he's taken a few hits. It's really been those green dogs or the delayed pressure from linebackers. When that back ends up blocking, a linebacker can blitz a little late, and the low line hasn't seen him.
Batted away. Florida thought they jumped. T.J. Carter able to get his mitts on it.
Maybe trying to take advantage of Marquan McCall and a nose guard, the true freshman getting some playing time. 6'3", 368. Matt House telling me before the game, don't want to play him, might have to play him. We have a lot of confidence in him, just not sure if he's ready.
He's a big boy, 50 down there.
Not sure the training table's ready for him when he rolls in either.
Second and 15 after the incompletion and the false start on the play before. Allen creeping up from the edge. Play clock's at one. Here comes Allen. Franks rolls the opposite way. Will fire a laser, incomplete. Trying to find Freddie Swain. T.J. Carter lost his hat. Third and 15.
That's a tough throw there, moving Felipe Franks to the left as a right-handed quarterback. It's always difficult to flip your hips quickly and drive a ball accurately 15, 20, 25 yards down the field, let alone great tight coverage by Kentucky.
Alabama hammered Arkansas State tonight. Georgia knocked off South Carolina in convincing fashion. 41-17. Third and long for Franks. They cross it up front again. Franks on the run, being chased, trying to direct traffic. And he's able to get it out of bounds, incomplete. And we got a flag on the play, multiple flags. Mark Stoops, furious. We've got two flags, one at the Florida 45, another one at the Kentucky 42. David Smith and his crew will sort it out.
There were two fouls on the play. Pass interference on the offense, number 89. The penalty is declined. An eligible receiver downfield, number 64 on the offense. That penalty is declined. Result of the play, fourth down.
So Florida will punt it away. We've talked about the losing streak. It's been since 1986 that Kentucky has beaten Florida. It is since 1979 that Kentucky last won a game in this building. And there have been games where Florida has put up monster numbers offensively in this series here at the Swamp. Bouvier rushes up to take it at the 21-yard line. 36-yard punt. Cats will look to add to their lead, up 14-10 on Florida. Let's take you back, November 15th, 1986. It was a cold afternoon in Lexington. Mark Higgs had 27 carries for 97 yards. The only touchdown, Carwell Gardner was able to sack Kerwin Bell. And with under a minute left, Ricky Natil fumbled. Kentucky recovered to ice the game. And the Cats snapped a five-game losing streak to Kentucky to win 10-3. They haven't won since. But since that win, there's been a lot of Kentucky success. All-Americans, draft picks, SEC Player of the Year, and Tim Couch. Well, they've had plenty of talent, enough to win.
I'm talking, they've had good football teams. Two eras come to mind. The Andre Woodson team, Randall Cobb, Jacob Tamming, Wesley Woodyard on defense. Really good ball club. And then, obviously, you got Tim Couch, number one overall draft pick, throwing the football to Craig East. You think about those two teams not being able to get a win against Florida. Just mind-boggling.
David Bouvier with a 14-yard reception. Kentucky's going to go tempo here. They'll replace Bouvier with C.J. Conrad, who has a couple of catches.
I love the tempo here. Keep momentum going. Keep positive plays moving in the right direction. Florida might bring some pressure up top here.
That's Chauncey Gardner-Johnson. Swing pass to Bowden. Stiff arm. Room on the sideline. And finally, pop by Donovan Steiner.
That's just a great job right there by Terry Wilson. That's not an RPO. That was a pre-snap decision. They roll a defender up to the right. That means there's not enough numbers to block, and you leave one on the outside. Flip it out to your playmaker. Go one-on-one. Great pre-snap decision there by Terry Wilson.
All you kids out there, if you're going to be passionate about something growing up, whatever you're going to be later in life, be as passionate as Jordan Rodgers is about RPOs,
what is it,
and what isn't an RPO.
Yeah, you know what? That term gets thrown around so cavalier in this day and age. Just because you stick the ball in a running back's gut and you pull it and throw it. No. An RPO is made after the snap. That decision is made post-snap. That decision down there by Terry Wilson was a pre-snap decision.
We all need something in our life that we're as passionate about as you are. What is and what is not an RPO. You're like the Paw Patrol to my three-year-old daughter.
See, look here. Florida's going to roll up, bring pressure right here. Kentucky's trying to run the football right now. Terry Wilson's like, we don't got numbers. We got one-on-one out here in this area over there where I'm scribbling. Let's give it to my playmaker and let him go. Pre-snap decision is not an RPO. That's a built-in. This is a run play to the left with a built-in what we call key screen to the right, which means one guy and a blocker. And if you have numbers, make the game a two-on-two instead of running into a blitz.
Florida will be down to its third-string middle linebacker. Rashad Jackson will come off for at least a play. They're already without David Reese. He's still out with a leg injury. He did not play last week either. So James Houston had a big fumble recovery earlier this game. Is the next man up for Florida at that mic position. Houston's just a freshman. They will try to hand it off, but there's a flag and movement up front for Kentucky. Call this place.
False start. 77 offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
This place gets so loud that Kentucky has had to change how they go with center quarterback communication out of the shotgun.
Not sure that was the issue there, Tom, but you're right. You see Drake Jackson looking down between his legs to get the leg lift from Terry Wilson. Most teams in the gun nowadays, they use the clap. Remember talking to Lane Kiffin about this a few years ago? He told us the clap is louder than any stadium that you'll play in or anything you can verbalize. Obviously, this place is loud enough where the clap doesn't work.
Wilson had to lift his leg twice before that flag a moment ago, and we've got multiple flags here as he goes down for a 2-yard loss.
Where it gets tricky, Tom, is the timing. Defenses time your head lift, so you look down and they get a beat on that. So you have to be conscious of it and change up the timing of your snap from when you actually look up.
You'll see formation back on the offense. Five players in the backfield. The penalty is declined. Second down.
A loss of two officially. So second and long now for Kentucky. Terry Wilson, 8 of 13 through the air for 93 yards. He has rushed for 107 on only 9 carries. Isaiah Epps is the man in motion. Conrad's got a shift. Kentucky looks a little bit lost. Maybe a lot lost. And they find Benny Snell. 1 yard. James Houston, who just entered the game for Rashad Jackson, had to stop. And they got to shove Voshon Joseph away from the pile.
Now, Voshon Joseph is an athletic linebacker for Florida and a guy that when he was asked about Benny Snell this week, he said, he's all right. Benny Snell's more than all right. But listen to this crowd on a third and long.
Play action. Wilson lets it go. Bowden gets deep. Got it! Touchdown, Kentucky! 54 yards to silence a crowd at the Swamp.
You might never hear a stadium get that loud and that quiet that quickly. Terry Wilson has done everything tonight with his legs. This time, an absolute rocket, and so good being patient. The first window's not there. Waits to the second window on the other side of Juwan Taylor, the safety to the field. There's not many guys that have the arm strength to wait for a second window on a post route.
That drive started at Kentucky's own 17-yard line. Five plays that cover 78 yards. They convert another third down. They are 8 of 9 on third down tonight. Averaging 9.5 yards a play after that strike to Bowden. Can they do it? All right, Dari, thanks. Perhaps an upset brewing here at the Swamp if we didn't get one at Williams-Brice Stadium today, 21-10. Meanwhile, A&M trying to come back on Clemson. It's 28-10 Clemson. Kyle Field losing its mind in the fourth quarter. Pardon me, 28-20. 5 minutes into the fourth quarter in Aggieland. A moment ago, what a throw from Terry Wilson.
Yeah, this was truly unbelievable. Great patience by Terry Wilson. You can have a post route coming from Lynn Bowden here, and the guy you want to worry about is this safety. The first window you can throw in is usually right here, which ends up being covered. And Terry Wilson has the wherewithal to wait and sit on it. That's because he knows how strong his arm is. But you see, right as he lets it go, he's going to be throwing this ball over here, not over here, because the safety dropped right down the middle. And that's just not many quarterbacks, I'm telling you, make that decision, let alone have the arm strength and accuracy to make that throw a second window on a post route. That's big time.
Felipe Franks has a big time arm. He's got man coverage and it's knocked away. Lonnie Johnson Jr. was all over Tyree Cleveland.
I guess that's where length at corner pays off, playing the ball off the back of your helmet.
Yeah, there are some tall DBs here for Kentucky. Lonnie Johnson, 6'3". Chris Wester, he hasn't seen much time tonight, is 6'4". Derek Beatty goes 6'3".
That's like Dan Mullen mentioned when we were talking about Kentucky's defenses. You know, they don't have the five-star guys on the back end, but they go get a three-star corner that's 6'3 or 6'4".
Franks rolls right, fires deep. It is incomplete. Van Jefferson stumbled a bit, and perhaps because he was pushed, he draws a flag on Lonnie Johnson.
Guys, I'm watching Mark Stoops right here on the sideline. He's giving the referee everything he's got. Not happy about this call.
These are the mistakes you can't
pass
have.
Pass interference on the defense, number 6. 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
But, Tom, I don't agree with this one. You're going to allow some hand fighting. There's not enough there, in my opinion, to throw a flag. But still, if you're Kentucky, you remember last year was the mental mistakes late in the game that cost them. They should have won that ball game. You got to have the mental fortitude late in this game to not make mistakes like that, albeit I don't believe that should have been a flag. You got to have extreme focus here towards the end of this game if you're Kentucky to close this one out.
Kentucky led 27-14 late last year. They lost 28-27. Franks again wants to go deep. That one was out of bounds. Looking for Trayvon Grimes. What do you think about the play call?
I mean, it's surprising. Looking over here, Jordan Scarlett, still just 5 rushing attempts for 20 yards. And you're going play action shot, play action shot. I don't mind shots every now and then, but Dan Mullen said it himself. Run the football to set up the play action pass. They're doing that in reverse right now, and there's just nothing open down the field.
going a little bit bigger as they bring in R.J. Raymond as an H-back. Franks is now under center. And they'll hand it off on second and 10. Scarlett ducks in and pops out, and he gets brought down by the face mask, and that's an easy flag for the line judge. Chris Westry had a terrible penalty last week against Central Michigan, ejected for targeting in the second quarter.
Personal foul, face mask, number 21 on the defense. 15-yard penalty added to the end of the run. First down.
Again, mental focus. That's not a physical mistake there. That's something you got to know when you're tackling. You cannot have your hands up around the helmet of the running back.
Franks pulls it back from Scarlett. And Raymond has it knocked out of his hands at the last second by Josh Allen, who was down in coverage. What can't Josh Allen do?
He can do everything. 6'5", 260. Not only is he catching the attention of NFL scouts because of how he can rush the quarterback, but it's things like this. He's in great coverage, turns his head like a DB. The only ball that could have beat him was a back shoulder. But even as a coverage guy, you know, R.J. Raymond, he's a fullback tight end. He's not gonna be the guy that's running one direction and snagging a back shoulder. So great coverage by Josh Allen.
Second down, 10. Here comes a blitz. Franks kicks it to the outside. Kadarius Toney. He is electric. And he's able to gain extra yardage with a stiff arm of Lonnie Johnson. It goes for 19. Toney was suspended last week. One of seven Florida players who didn't see action because of suspension. And he can be an impact player for him.
And I'm surprised it took this long to say Kadarius Toney's name. He's as dynamic of a playmaker the Florida has, and you're going to see him taking the direct snap here.
Can't quite find the edge. He can do a lot of things with the ball in his hand. He was a high school quarterback. We were talking with Juwan Taylor, and he was telling us about Kadarius Toney. He said, I was already at Florida and watching a playoff game. Toney was playing my old high school team. He scored seven touchdowns on his own, and the only reason we won the game is because he had to come out after his shoes came untied, and the backup QB threw a pick six.
He's a special athlete. He'll go wildcat. They'll throw the ball with him. Jet sweep. Just haven't found a way to get him the ball tonight. Maybe one of the reasons we haven't seen this Florida offense hitting on all cylinders.
Let's take a look at the road to the championship brought to you by Mercedes-Benz. And we go to Columbia, South Carolina for action earlier today. Georgia, the heavy favorites in the East. A lot of folks thought this was going to be their big test. Well, they went on the road and they took care of South Carolina 41-17. 271 rushing yards. Jake Fromm was 15 of 18 for a 196. Jake Bentley threw two picks, including a pick six. Elsewhere in the league, Nick Fitzgerald back to action. Mississippi State rolls in the Little Apple. Alabama had no issues. It looks like Jalen Hurts won't redshirt after all. He played a lot in that game against Archie State. And A&M is only down 8 in the fourth quarter at Kyle Field.
How about that? I mean, surprised to see Jalen Hurts in cleanup or earlier than cleanup when you think the best thing to do is redshirt him. And at worst, if you're in the playoffs, you have a guy that's still got a couple games you could play late in the season if you need it. But, man, that last game that's going on right now, Clemson, Texas A&M, how about that? 28-20, 6 minutes left in the fourth quarter.
A&M punting it away. Second and 8 for Felipe Franks. Slippage on the ground game and only 1 yard for Jordan Scarlett. Why has Scarlett been so ineffective tonight?
Well, they just haven't given him enough touches for starters. Only 7 touches in this entire game. He's got to get more than that. He's your bell cow. He's your best running back. Got to get him more involved, even if it's just to set up the pass. But there hasn't been a ton of push. The plays he has made, he's escaped, bounced it outside, and done something as an athlete. Not a ton of holes for him to run through.
I'd get 25 behind 65 if it were me, guys.
Well, they empty the backfield and spread him out left. Hammond in motion. They'll go four receivers to Franks' left. He looks right all the way. Now back to the left. Now back to the right. Now he's going to run. Flag on the play will likely be holding. And the pass ends up incomplete as he tried to thread the needle to Tony. Well, you can see they want to put Tony in one-on-one situations to get him the ball. But he was well covered at the outset.
Holding, number 65 on the offense. Penalty is declined. Fourth down.
That's right tackle Juwan Taylor. 24th consecutive start tonight.
Thought he played best among that offensive line last week. I know it's a brutal holding call there on third down, but thought Juwan Taylor was phenomenal in the opener for the Florida Gators.
And working against Calvin Taylor here, he's in good position. His hand, right hand, gets on top, and then as Taylor tries to escape, his left hand hooks him around the waist.
36-yard attempt for Evan McPherson, the freshman. Tommy Townsend, the punter, is the holder. The right hash, it will curl in. No, they say it was wide. Boy, certainly looked like it came back in over the right upright. That will end a streak for Florida, where they had made 20 consecutive field goals. You be the judge. When it goes over the post, it has to be clearly to the inside of the upright to be good.
This is the shot right here. Can't really tell at what point it's crossing the threshold of the crossbar, but that was close.
And it is not reviewable. A few years ago in this series, Florida caught a break when a play clock seemingly read zeros. And now Dan Mullen thinking it's Kentucky that caught a break in this one. Here's Benny Snell. A gain of three. It started wide, there's no question.
Boy, like I said, you can't tell at what point. The refs standing there at the crossbar and at the upright have the best view. I mean, as an armchair quarterback sitting here, it looks close.
It's got to be clearly inside the upright to be good when it is above the upright. It'll make the Florida fans feel any better. Second and six. Benny Snell to the outside, trucking guys. And so of all the ways Kentucky has lost games in this series, it seems they finally catch a break. I think it was good.
Sure looks good. I don't think that's the best view. I think the behind view is the best view, and to me it looked good. But like I said, that ref is standing at the crossbar looking straight up, and you said it's got to clearly be inside. And so on those replays, you can't tell at what point it's even with the crossbar to evaluate if it's inside or not.
Kentucky trying to go back in time. They've only lost twice when leading after three quarters under Stoops. One of those a heartbreaker last year against Florida. Can they reverse the trend? 3 minutes or less, brought to you by Geico.
See Terry Wilson do it with his legs on runs, but even more dangerous when an athletic quarterback gets outside the pocket, keeps his eyes downfield, and delivers a strike. And Felipe Franks, limited opportunities, has been good as well. But in the end, the difference in this game has been Terry Wilson's athleticism and his arm as well on two big touchdown passes. They have Kentucky up 21-10 here at the start of the fourth quarter.
Last year's heartbreaker was a 24-14 lead for Kentucky going into the fourth quarter. They would grow that lead. Here's Benny Snell, and he loses yardage. Jabari Zuniga there for Florida.
Number 92, Jabari Zuniga. Makes a stop. Loss of one.
In the Commonwealth, when it comes to this series, they haven't been all happy and bright since 1986. Certainly not Mary. Second and 11.
Check to the sideline. They're going to get a one safety look. Nope, now Florida's going to audible out of that. As one team checks, so is the other.
Time out. Kentucky, they're first.
Eddie Grant talking it over with Mark Stoops. It's the second time tonight Kentucky's had to use a timeout to avoid a delay a game penalty. Is Mark Stoops having headset issues?
He's having some kind of issues right now.
So how long has it been? Well, Jordan, since you weren't around in 1986, let's tell you about it. This is what it looked like. Legend of Zelda was just released this weekend. Microsoft was available at $21 a share. Halle Berry was the runner-up for Miss USA in 1986. Mike Tyson was on his way to become the youngest heavyweight champion in history. Oprah Winfrey's show was just starting. And oh, by the way, you see they're inverted. Top Gun was the highest grossing movie of the year. Last time Kentucky won in this series. Here's Snell on second and 11 and a flag down.
Holding 64 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replay second down.
The senior, George Asafo Ajay.
Too bad it's going to erase a really good gain here. They went unbalanced, four receivers to the top, which means only three defenders to the right side of that Kentucky offensive line. Kentucky moving in the wrong direction. This crowd's getting loud.
Benny Snell dances his way. Gain of seven. This is the first SEC start for junior college transfer Terry Wilson. How do you think he's handled this environment tonight?
Exceptionally well. We saw the turnovers early, the fumble, the interception. Those things are going to happen. Physical mistakes are going to happen. But mentally, he's made the right reads. He's used his legs. He's done some special things tonight. We're going to need a little bit more of that magic here on third and 13.
Wilson looking for Snell out of the backfield. Snell makes the first man miss. The second man doesn't. It was Chauncey Gardner-Johnson who cuts him down. It'll bring up fourth down for Kentucky, leading by 11. Dramatic moment at Kyle Field. Texas A&M fumbled moments ago. They trailed Clemson by 8. It was ruled a touchback, and Jimbo Fisher's losing his mind. Swain asks for a fair catch, takes it at the 27-yard line. 41-yard punt from Max Duffy, the sophomore from Australia. Thanks. We watched that play about 15 times a moment ago, and it looked like it did not go over the pylon.
Yeah.
Should have been out where the fumble was in A&M possession.
Especially that pylon cam right down the line. Sure looked like it was out of bounds before.
Malik Davis is in a running back for Florida. He'll get the carry on first down. And Davis is able to power his way for a gain of 10.
Number 92, Will Hoskins.
A couple nice pulls there by the Florida offensive line. G-scheme, blocking back, pulling around. That's an issue that Dan Mullen's had with this team, something they want to improve upon. finally get it going there late here in the fourth quarter.
Florida has run 47 plays tonight. They've thrown it more than they've run it. 22 runs, 25 passes. Franks fires outside, dropped up the hands of Tyree Cleveland. Adrian Middleton brought the coverage.
Boy,
that is a fifth drop for Florida.
And a tough, dangerous throw on the run from the left hash with a flat defender underneath. Felipe Franks is lucky he got enough on that ball to beat the flat defender. Don't love the play call there.
And they've thrown a lot on first down tonight.
A lot of shots on first down.
Especially second half, they came out looking deep early in the series. Franks intercepted! It's Darius West, and Kentucky has the takeaway here in the fourth quarter with an 11-point lead.
That is a monumental mistake by Felipe Franks there. This is a nice, easy concept on the left side here. It's going to be smash. You're going to have a corner route and a hitch on the outside. You're really just high-low read on the corner, but this ball has to be out. To the field, you have a little bit more time. To the boundary, it's got to be out, and it's got to be outside. You cannot miss that ball inside. You see Felipe falling off that throw a little bit. When you're off balance as a quarterback, you're going to be inaccurate, and you can't leave that inside.
Kentucky is 11 minutes and 39 seconds away from ending the longest continuous losing streak in major conference football. They've lost 31 in a row to Florida. Wilson swings it to the outside, Lynn Bowden. And Bowden gets gang tackled for no gain. Remember last year in the fourth quarter, it was a 27-14 lead for Kentucky. Before Florida, under second string quarterback Jack Del Rio, came storming back in the game.
Got to protect the ball. If you're Terry Wilson here, I imagine we're going to get a handoff, but secure everything from the snap to the handoff. Can't afford to let that ball hit the ground now.
Snell through the pile. 8 yards. Last year's SEC leading rusher.
How patient is Benny Snell?
I mean,
presses the line of scrimmage, Jordan, and he never, never finishes a run with his shoulder pads facing towards the sideline. Not one time. They're always facing towards the end zone. Every single play.
Sometimes when he hits that hole, Cole, it's almost like he's going slow motion, but it's that patience, right? He's waiting for blocks to get set up. It's a true sign of a veteran running back that knows how to read and set things up.
Timeout. Florida. They're first.
Kentucky looking to add to its lead. Third and two, and we return you to the Swamp.
SEC Saturday Night is presented by Holiday Inn Express. Be the readiest.
Gators fans trying to channel Tom Petty. They don't want to back down. They haven't backed down against Kentucky. Here's a look at the most consecutive wins over a major opponent. Notre Dame, Navy until 2006 and won 43 straight. Nebraska steamrolled Kansas for 36 consecutive years. That covered a couple different conferences. Oklahoma did the same to K-State from the Big 7 to the Big 8 days, ending in 68. And Florida has beat Kentucky 31 consecutive. That is the longest active streak. Benny Snell Jr. is in a Wildcat. And Snell bottled up behind the line. Ja'Kai Polite, the first man there. It's a loss of two.
26, Benny Snell Jr.
And that is a heck of a play there by Ja'Kai Polite, coming off the complete end to get all the way down to the opposite A-gap and make that play. The 6'5", 260-pound defensive end is a freak.
They're going to go for it, fourth and three. They've got a good kicker, but they lost their all-time leading scorer at that position. Florida showing pressure. trying to get him to jump, I suppose. It'd be a 52-yard field goal from here if they wanted to try it. Play clock will run out.
Delay of game on the offense, number 3, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Kentucky will punt it away. A&M made a go of it. They just scored a touchdown to pull within 2 of Clemson, but with 46 seconds left, they could not convert the 2-point conversion. It's 28-26 with under a minute to go at Kyle Field. Clemson in front.
What an effort by that Texas A&M team and a young Kellen Mond.
Max Duffy will try to pin the Gators back. Florida might be offside near side. Duffy hangs it up. It'll come down inside the 5. And they get it at the 1. Fantastic job by Zach Johnson to come out of the end zone and down a 37-yard punt. Let's check in with Dari. Dari, thank you. Clock running there, and A&M out of timeouts. What an effort by Jimbo Fisher's team. Long way to go for Felipe Franks of Florida. He's operating from his own end zone. Felipe Franks originally committed to LSU, but when the coaching situation came into question with Les Miles, he decided to reopen his recruitment.
Please reset the game clock to 8 minutes 41 seconds. 8-4-1.
He was so dialed into LSU that his mother was driving him there every weekend. She's racked up about 160,000 miles on her Toyota Prius. He said it's roomier than you might think, but after all that, he decided, you know what, coaching question marks with LSU, I'm gonna go straight to Florida. Part-time starter last year, named the starter this season ahead of Kyle Trask. From the end zone, comes to check over the middle. That's good for a Florida first down and Freddie Swain.
That's just a great job by Felipe Franks. I asked him about what his favorite route to throw was. He said a deep ball. I said, okay, what's your least favorite? What do you need to work on? He says that route right there, the dagger route, the deep dig. Patient job looking front side, coming back to your third read there for a wide open game.
Steps up, fires again, and this one incomplete. It was wide of LaMichael Piron.
Middle pressure from Adrian Middleton there, coming over right guard Fred Johnson. Nice inside move, able to force Felipe Franks to just step to his left a touch, thus an errant pass.
Yeah, and Middleton's playing a big role, as you said, with Bohana out. Middleton's down about 25, actually up about 25 pounds from last year. He was heavy, then last year slimmed some weight. Now he's got good weight on, and he's using it well in the middle of that offensive line.
Third year as a starter. Here's Piron. He's got room. 13-yard run around the edge for LaMichael Piron.
See Florida starting to push with a little sense of urgency. You don't need to panic. You don't need to go full speed right now. Just under 8 minutes. You have both your timeouts. You're down 2 scores. You need to push some urgency, but don't panic. You can still run, still take what the defense gives you.
Franks fires a bullet, nearly picked up and through the hands of Mike Edwards. Missed opportunity for Kentucky. When they have directed Felipe Franks to get the ball to Kadarius Toney, he is zeroed in on it.
Yeah, and this is great. I said, take what the defense gives you. He wants to throw this deep comeback. He puts this on a line. This ball really needs to be over the top of that linebacker. He throws it with too flat of an arc. and almost throws an interception. Ball's got to have a little more air. Level two ball. About 10 to 15 yards of air there. That's a completion.
One touchdown and one pick for Franks. Big hole. And Pirine has another first down. This is a drive that started up Florida's 1 yard line.
It's the run game that's really getting things going here. Haven't seen much of it all night. But Pirine in there, the changeup back.
Play action, lost the football. Franks just didn't take it with him, and they'll end up losing a yard.
Boy, can't have that. Got to be really firm. Yeah, you see that? Franks is trying to flip for the laces as he's doing a play action. So as he's sticking the ball in the running back's gut, he's trying to flip for the laces. You got to secure the fake, and then you can find the laces afterwards.
Complete, Van Jefferson. And he bends it over the middle for a first down. 18-yard catch and run. Kentucky's cramping up again, and Felipe Franks just laughing. He must think that Kentucky's doing that to try to mess with their tempo. It's Phil Hoskins. They will tend to Hoskins. Florida trying to mount a comeback. 6.5 minutes to go.
I think that's the most mentally and emotionally challenging road game of the season. They're at Tennessee the week before. Jordan Rogers will tell you, you don't just roll into Nashville on the 13th of October
game,
and win
baby.
That football game. Obviously, Georgia game's not at home. At Florida State as well. Road schedule brutal for these Florida Gators this year, Tom.
Big time hit by Adrian Middleton. It's a loss of two.
Yeah, what a play there. We've said Middleton's name a couple times tonight. He's going to go catch a breather. But he's been disruptive over those guards and centers all night.
Second and 13. Crowd anxious watching that clock tick away. Incomplete. Flag down.
Jefferson and Malik Davis almost ran into each other there. I think Jefferson even saw the ball coming. A crossing route from the opposite side.
Pass interference on the offense. Number 16. Penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot. Replay, second down. Okay.
So Freddie Swain with a costly flag for Florida. Second down, halfway to Hazard for the Gators.
That second down, Kentucky's playing way off. I try to get an easy completion here, get some yards after catch. Make it a more manageable third down.
Three-man rush. Franks over the middle. Incomplete, too high for Freddie Swain.
See, an incompletion there really hurts you. I mean, it's four down territory, so you're thinking you still have two downs, but they got almost 30 yards here. Really needed some positive yards on that play. I would like to see a quick pass play, get the ball out of Felipe's hands into a guy like Kadarius Toney or Van Jefferson and let them try to pick up 10. I'd still say do the same thing here because you know you're going to go for it on fourth. And or get yourself in a manageable field goal range. Need about 15 yards here.
They're going to run it on the quarterback draw. Franks gets a couple of big blocks, stays on his feet inside the 40. ...19-yard run by Franks. How about that play call?
That's great. I was looking at the 35-yard line thinking you got to get inside that if you're going to even think about kicking a field goal. As a quarterback right here, you're taught hash number sidelines. All right, get upfield, get vertical, keep working towards the sideline. It's a great job by Felipe Franks to get his team in striking range.
Well, they have a freshman kicker with a big leg. Evan McPherson set the Alabama state record for a field goal without a tee when he knocked through a 60-yarder. Incredible crowd, and it didn't bother Florida. It bothered Kentucky. Twice they left a wide receiver wide open. That was Tyree Cleveland on a fourth down. And then this one, the game winner. With 46 seconds left, Luke Del Rio found Freddie Swain. A key holding penalty back Kentucky up. And Austin McGinnis, their all-time leading scorer, came up short on a 56-yarder. They have lost in this series in every way imaginable. And now they're facing Florida and a 4th-and-7.
Josh Allen on Martez Ivy here. Keep an eye on that. They're going to throw it. They might not have a lot of time.
They dump it underneath. It's good for a first down. And LaMichael Perine. And Perine's got it inside the 15. Florida able to convert the fourth down. It's a pushing and shoving afterwards.
A great job. Josh Allen does bring a little pressure here. And instead of chipping on him, as you think that Perine would be there for that reason, he slips out. Linebackers don't get there in time. It's a great design. Because if you're Kentucky, you're thinking that back's there to help on Josh Allen. And he just slips free.
Kentucky runs a man off late. Under 5 minutes to go. Franks wants to throw. End zone shot. Incomplete. Almost intercepted. Once again, he found the wrong jersey.
Yeah, they love this one-on-one matchup in the red zone with Van Jefferson. But Felipe's just been off. That's not a good ball. Your only shot here is back shoulder. You want it up on the ear hole towards the sideline. He's been a little off on every throw these past few drives.
13th play of the drive that started all the way back at the 1 yard line.
Tell you what, QB draw here. Just four guys in the box for Kentucky right now and five offensive linemen. They're going to look to the sideline, and Dan Mullen's going to give them a play.
They did it on a key third down earlier. Play clock is at one. Franks on the draw through traffic, gets cut down and is able to find three, but that's it. TJ Carter there for the stop for Kentucky.
And still, if you're Felipe Franks, it's 3rd-and-7, but don't think seven. Think 4 or 5 at worst, right? You know you're going in two down range here. Unless you're going to do a chip shot here, but Dan Mullen looks like he's pushing his chips onto the table, and he wants 7 here.
Swain, the man in motion. They load up the right side. Franks looking that way, steps up and fires. It is caught, and that is right at the marker. It's Swain, and we'll see if they give him the spot. They do. 1st-and-goal, Florida. 3:58 and counting.
Florida's going quick now. Kentucky's subbing.
This is what got him in trouble last year at Commonwealth. To the end zone! Touchdown, Freddie Swain! Florida marches 99 yards on 15 plays in a 4-yard scoring strike from Franks. It is a one-score game.
And I absolutely love the play call from Dan Mullen. You get a first down. You hurry up to the line of scrimmage. Kentucky subbing, guys. They're disheveled on the defensive side. And you slip Freddie Swain into the flats for a nice, easy throw for Felipe Franks, which he almost missed. But now you got to get the two-point conversion.
They'll put the ball on the left hash. Florida 0-for-1 on two-point plays. Franks looks back over the middle. Lobs it in zone. Tipped. Caught out of the back of the end zone. Malik Davis was the one who had it. He was wide open.
And Tom, what'd you say earlier? You can't go broke taking a profit. Nearly an identical play. It's the same concept.
Florida kicks it away. Nobody back to receive it. And it'll be a touchback. So let's take you first to the touchdown.
little hurry up, get to the line of scrimmage. Play action front side there, and you leak Freddie Swain. He made a great catch on the first down on a throw behind him, and another throw at his heels for the touchdown. And this is, you just don't have a chance here. That's your outlet if everything goes wrong. Great coverage, as we mentioned, by Josh Allen, a defensive end out there on a receiver, on a tight end. But you had the flat route for a two-point conversion, as easy as it comes.
Kentucky wants to run the clock. They'll do it with Benny Snell. And Snell gets taken down by Rashad Jackson after a gain of two.
Love the formation. Two tight ends with an H-back. Oh, big bodies. Some bonus bigs in the lineup for the Wildcats.
Florida
uses a timeout. They left, like, what, 10 seconds on the table?
I think they're going to put it back on. Mullen's talking to the ref right now.
Yep, 3:29 will be the time remaining as he adjusts the clock.
Thank you.
Second and seven now for Benny Snell, Kentucky. How about the job by Felipe Franks to go 99 yards to make it a one-score game?
Yeah, I mean, for a guy that struggled most of this game with accuracy issues, threw an interception on a really bad ball, to gather yourself, to not panic, to not go into the dumps mentally as a quarterback, to say, you know what, I can still do this. Really good job. Still not accurate, but really good job getting the ball to his guys when he needs to.
How hard is it to be effective when you're not throwing the ball well?
And he's not. Even on these plays where they've scored or made big plays, the ball has been inaccurate, but the fortitude and confidence to keep coming back and making those throws, that goes a long way if you're Florida to see Felipe Franks doing that.
We'll see if Felipe Franks gets another chance. Flags on the play coming out of the timeout. 12 men on the field for Florida. Out of a timeout. Inexcusable.
Jeez.
Illegal substitution. 12 players on defense. Penalty is 5 yards from the previous spot. Second down.
That is... that, I mean, what are they? Second and two?
Yeah, second and seven to second and two. It changes everything for a team just wanting to run the clock.
Can't have that. You said it. Out of a timeout. Cannot have personnel issues.
Here's Snell. He fights for one. Rashad Jackson playing for the injured David Reese is in on another stop for Florida.
And a great tackle. I mean, that's one thing. When you're a backup playing behind David Reese, you don't get a ton of time to get comfortable with what you're seeing. Made a quick decision, great tackle to save that and force a third down.
This place is rocking on a third and one.
Kentucky's going heavy. Tight end fullback in the game.
Benny Snell to the outside. Big block on the edge. And Snell takes it for a Kentucky first down. Bunchy Stallings was a road grader, Cole Kublik.
Wonderful block, wonderful hook, pulling around. But, Tom, I tell you this, as an offensive lineman, you have to love a running back who presses the line of scrimmage. Benny Snell presses the line of scrimmage on every play, makes such a late cut and a beautiful cut, and then gets north and south near the sideline. Excellent job by the Kentucky O-line and obviously Benny Snell.
And a full slab from Bunchy Stallings with a flat back to lead the way for Benny Snell.
Give me that slab, Jordan Rogers.
Oh, it was given.
Benny Snell will take the direct snap. Kentucky trying to end the longest consecutive losing streak in major college football. They haven't beaten Florida since 1986. Cole Kublik had hair.
Timeout, Florida. Their third and final timeout of the half.
The streak is 31 consecutive games.
This will be a 30-second timeout. Please reset the game clock to 2 minutes, 4 seconds. 2:04.
Kentucky hasn't won here in Gainesville since 1979.
Thank you.
They got torched by Warfel and Doering. Chris Leak had a major comeback. They lost in triple overtime. there have been all sorts of wins for Florida in this series. And Mark Stoops thought they had ripped the monkey off the back last year. They're denied with 43 seconds left. We're on the flight on the way home out of Lexington the next day, and a woman sitting right behind me tapped me on the shoulder. She said, I've been coming to these games for 30 years. I'm never coming back. I want to call her, sell her some tickets now if they can finish this one off.
Not completely over yet. Kentucky still needs a first down. If Florida stops them here twice, could still have around 30 seconds or so. But you would probably need to go the length of the field in that case. But you got to get stops here first.
Snell brought down by Jackson again. He picks up one.
Benny Snell Jr.
Florida's out of timeouts. The clock will tick down.
And for an inexperienced quarterback here with Terry Wilson, got to let all the seconds come off the clock. So walk to the line of scrimmage, get your eyes on that play clock, and do not snap the ball. Mind you, Benny Snell, the veteran, is going to be back there. Milk that clock as long as possible.
On third and seven. Maybe a yard that time. So Florida will get another crack at it with about 40 seconds left, maybe less.
And I bet Kentucky takes a delay of game here. Back yourself up 5 yards. Give a little more cushion to try to pin Florida back inside the 10 or inside the 5.
It was a fantastic punt from Max Duffy last time. He's from Perth, Australia. When he showed up in Lexington this summer, he had never before put on football pads or a helmet. They had to walk him through that. They had to teach him how to wear the equipment. And now he's trying to pin Florida deep. The Aussie will send a bouncer inside the 20. It's lost and then recovered. Freddie Swain had to go right through the wickets. It'll be a long field for Florida. 29 seconds left, 95 yards to go.
Trying to make a play, can't blame him, but got to get the ball first. Really lucky to be able to fall on it before Kentucky gets there. All right, if you're Florida and Felipe Franks now, you got to use the sidelines. Only 29 seconds left, zero timeouts. The clock will pause on a first down, so you can use the middle of the field, but you better make sure everybody is rushing to the ball. You need chunk plays, and a few of them really quick.
Jefferson to the left side. He's been Frank's favorite tonight. They'll dump it off. First down for Davis. Taken down at the 25.
It's a great first play. Got to get positive yards, get things going in the right direction. They better hurry to get this snap off. Clock is running.
It's at 16. Kadarius Toney outside on the right for Franks. Pressure flicks it. It'll go incomplete with 9 seconds left. You have time for two or just one?
Boy, I mean, you only got time for two if it's about 15 yards, 20 yards maybe on the sideline. And then hopefully get yourself in a situation where Felipe can reach the end zone with about a 65, 70-yard throw.
Kentucky fans have chewed their nails to the quick. They've suffered heartbreak time and again in this series. They're 9 seconds away from flushing all those bad thoughts. Trips to the right, Toney on the outside. Play clock is at 3.
Try to work the sideline here.
Frank steps up. Hit as he falls. It falls incomplete, and they catch a break. 4 seconds left. Mark Stoops is saying it was a fumble. They have now whistled it dead, and they will get it down to the goal line. And now the line judge says, touchdown, Kentucky. Unbelievable. Mark Stoops was yelling, go, go, go. And they're going to take a long look at this one.
At one of those plays, the refs are going to let that play out. Call it a fumble. It's a safe thing to do and review it to see if it was a forward pass or not. But you got to play to the whistle.
The previous play is under further review. The ruling on the field was a fumble recovered by Kentucky.
Josh Allen hit him. Very rarely do you see a ball come out of a quarterback's hands forward ruled a fumble.
Yeah, and they'll have a good view on this to see if that ball was moving at all. What you're looking for is to see if the ball was moving before the arm starts to come forward. You can see Felipe stepping up in the pockets here. It was Josh Allen that hit it. We need a closer look than that.
Devontae Robinson ended up with it. He almost gave up on the play, but
almost tossed it to the ref.
And he had a chance to be taken down by Tyler Jordan or have the ball stolen, and then his extra effort got him over the plane.
I think that's a fumble, fellas.
Here's a better look. Yes,
oh, yeah.
Ball was out. And what a way for Kentucky, if the call stands, to end this streak with perhaps the most unbelievable play in this series.
And look who it was. From breaking up the two-point conversion play in coverage to beating the left tackle to force a fumble and close it out after a 31-year drought for Kentucky. Josh Allen was everything to Kentucky tonight.
Got his hat on the football. Excellent job, dip and rip right around the edge. Josh Allen, you mentioned it, Jordan's been all over the place. Pass coverage, pass rush, run stop. He's been a maniac tonight.
Mark Stoops recognized it early. It hadn't been whistled dead, and he was trying to encourage Devontae Robinson to go, go, go. Ron Leatherwood is the replay official. David Smith, the referee. What a game for Allen.
See it here again. That big loop. Felipe Franks got a big arm, but he does loop the ball in his takeaway.
Here's the call.
After further review, the ruling on the field of a fumble is confirmed. A touchdown was scored by Kentucky at the end of the play. Game is over.
Kentucky fans can excel. Finally, the streak is dead. ...27-16 is the final. Five tackles tonight for Josh Allen, including a sack. What a finish. Cole Kublik standing by with Mark Stoops.
Coach Stoops, 31 years. How does it feel?
It's hard to describe. You know, it's been a long time coming. We played them very well since I've been here, different games, and it's been very, very frustrating. Could not be more happy for our players. They just showed unbelievable character. They've been a joy to work with, and for our fan base that's waited a long, long time for this one. And, you know, sometimes it's a little undue to our players inheriting the 31 games. It puts a little bit extra stress on you, but they handled it super well.
You told me at halftime you were the more physical football team. What did this team prove to you tonight?
Well, we went out in the second half, and I think we ran it every snap and went down and scored, and that showed the character and the toughness of this team.
What does this win mean for your program?
It's another step. It's a long season, and we got to keep everything in perspective. You can't ever get too high or too low. It's a big win. I'm very, very proud of them, and it's another step.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
That is a very humble answer, because this is a monster win for this Kentucky program, which under Mark Stoops has gotten better each and every year from a win total perspective, and now an opportunity to snap what was the longest active losing streak against an opponent in major conference football. What a job by this entire Kentucky program. God. And the winners are joined by Cole, Terry Wilson, and Benny Snell.
We're going to do them both because I don't think it would be fair to take just Benny Snell or Terry Wilson. Benny, I'm going to start with you because you've been in this program a little bit longer. Just describe to me what you're feeling right now.
Oh, my adrenaline's up. The best feeling in the world. All my brothers fought. Terry fought. The linemen fought. We did a great job, man. Yeah, I'm blessed, man. I'm happy, bro. I'm proud of you too, baby. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? We did this from the ground. All the odds was against us. Man. Tebow, I don't even want to get into that, but we got a lot of odds against us, and we shot the world, man. I'm happy. Yeah. I'm happy.
Yeah. Benny, I know it's a team effort, but I saw you coming off the field a few times in the second half. How much of that load did you want on your shoulders?